green. I'm going to go ahead and lay some papers out because I'm not the smartest guy out there, even though I'm a Terrapin. I didn't. When I was 12 years old, getting ready to turn 13, and I'm laying in my bed, and my father comes in the room and picks me up out of the bed. He says, "Get your glove, get your bag, get your spikes, get your bag." I'm like, what are we going to do with this? Where are we going to go? It's 5:30 in the morning. He puts me in the car, and we drive 2.5 hours to the northern part of New York. Okay, I'm from Long Island, so we get on the north side of the city. He says, "Stay here in the car, Jeff. I'll be right back." He gets out. He walks over to the coach, and there's kids your size there. I'm 13 years old, and I didn't grow until I almost got to college. And he walks up to those guys, and he goes, "Oh, man, I'm sorry. I said, I thought this was a 13-year-old tryout. I drove my son 2.5 hours to be here. I screwed up. Do you mind if he gets on the field with you?" Guy's like, "Okay, he drove 2.5 hours. Why not? Bring him out here." I get out there, and I work out with these kids, scared to death, okay? He did that 3 more times to me. And why did he do that, okay? He did it because he put me in a situation early on to challenge myself and to see where I stacked up. So when we start to talk about USA Baseball and all these other programs that are out there, I'm very blunt, and Sean will tell you, I'm very blunt about the dynamics of youth travel showcase baseball. Even though I have an academy in Charlotte, North Carolina, and we're very successful with it, we carry one team per age group. One team per age group. And the reason we do that is because we're about development, okay? And we're also about, not only are we about development, but we're also about cuts. We cut kids from 10U all the way up. You have to earn your spot in this game every single level you go to. Did that with my father for 3 times, right? 4th time, guess what happened? The guy said, "We'll keep him on the team." And I made it up there for a purpose, okay? But I had an opportunity to challenge myself, and this is what's going on with USA Baseball right now. And I look around and see different uniforms, okay? I see the Canes, I see whatever groups that are around here. Okay, those things, when people call me and say, "My son plays for the Canes, my son's done X, Y, and Z, and he's been on this team," you know what that means to me? It means zero. And I don't mean it in a negative way. It means zero. I commend you guys for trying to put your sons in the best situation or what you think the best situation is. And it's not always putting them in a certain uniform. It's putting them in a situation where they're going to go ahead and they're going to have to challenge themselves. They're going to have to find out where you stack up every single day. And the way that you find out if you ever are going to stack up every single day is by doing something every single day. This isn't a game of sometimes, okay? There are 16 countries in Major League Baseball right now that are represented in the big leagues, okay? When I was coming up, Latinos were struggling to get in the game. The black player had just barely got in and broke through, and the better athletes were moving into the system. Now you got Koreans, Japanese, Italians, Australians, you go on and on and on. They're all over the place. So your level of competition is not what's in your league. Your level of competition is global. So with USA Baseball, what we do is we have the NTIS program, which is called the National Team Identification Series. And I run the Northeast and the Southeast region, okay? So we've built a scouting department. That means I control from Maine all the way down to Miami. And we go from 10U all the way up to 16U. And we only see the 10U's because we hope they want to make the 11U team, all right? They're not really, we're evaluating 10-year-old kids to try and make a national team. So there's levels involved. There's levels involved, and there's different challenges along the way. So we run round ones, okay? Round one is a pro-style workout. You get out there, and you do your best. We run the 60, well, we run the 30 in USA Baseball. And to me, that's more logical for you guys that are coaching. The 30 is more logical than the 60. The only guy that's running the 60 straight ahead is a guy that's going after a ball in the gap. So it's not really a true barometer, but it's been around forever, and scouts and recruiters are running, so work on that. Work on your 60 as well as your 30. But we'll run the 30, we'll do a pro-style infield, okay? We'll skill out, we'll do a lot of different things, we'll teach, we'll take BP, and from there we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna shake out the dead wood. Because USA Baseball asks us to give every single kid that has the desire to try and make a national team the opportunity to play. So if you got a glove and a bat and some shoes and you want to show up, you're welcome to show up and try out. But we'll weed it out pretty quick. We go to a round two regional after that. And we bring in all the kids that we selected out of our round ones into one area. So we have 15 states in the Northeast. and we have 8 states in the southeast. So you can imagine all the kids that we get to see when we bring them in. See how this thing is starting to condense, it's starting to compress? And then from there, we'll run a 2-day event. And that 2-day event will be the same thing. We'll run a pro style with extensive BP, extensive infield, extensive activity going on that we can skill evaluate, okay? And I want to talk about skill evaluation here in a little bit, because you guys are built on highlight films and not truly what it takes to be a good baseball player. And again, believe me, I don't say things to knock you guys down. I say things to give you more information than the other guy down the road has and to show you guys what it's going to take to get to that certain level. After day one, we sit down and we go through all the guys and we like, we skill them out and we highlight them. And then we break everybody up into teams. We go simulated games so we see live arms against live hitting. Because I'm telling you guys, when I talk about the highlight film, you go out pro style in front of anybody, okay? You can go pro style in front of anybody. I played with guys that were first round picks that couldn't get out of A ball because they didn't know how to play the game, okay? We can pro style out. You guys are taught to pro style out. You got trainers for your 60. You got guys like me that can teach you how to feel the ground ball. We got batting coaches that can give you the perfect swing, okay? All that stuff is there. And when you're throwing a 50-mile, a 58-mile-an-hour BP, you all look like superstars. And what you're going to do is you're going to get all that on video. You're going to get every bit of that on a video, and where are you going to send it? You're going to send it to a college coach. And every video that comes to a college coach has what? It's a highlight reel. Do you ever send a college coach a swing and miss? Do you ever send a college coach a pop-up, a rollover, a wild throw? Ever? We don't do that, okay? What we do is we go ahead and we build our own highlight field. And what happens in that highlight film is we start to believe it. We start to believe that we're that guy. So USA Baseball will take you through the process and it'll get heavy, okay? Because the end result is the national team, right? The national team, 18-man roster. We have 6 regions across the country. We see thousands of kids. It's tougher to make a USA national team than it is to make the big leagues, if you're in a minor league system. There's 30 teams. If you're in there, somebody's watching, you got a chance to kind of maneuver through. I played on 3 different teams in the big leagues, okay? They were all watching me through the minor leagues. They had a book on me, all right? My point in this, guys, is that I encourage everybody to step out and try USA Baseball. Not because it's USA Baseball. That's one reason. That's not the only reason. I encourage you guys to step out and put yourselves in situations that you are challenging yourselves. You have to find out where you sit in this game. And it's just not what's here in the D.C. area. It's not just here what's in the Northeast or the Southeast. Okay? Right now, for you guys, it's across the country. It is across the country. And you have to be prepared. And you have to understand that there's 2 parts of this game for you guys right now. Okay? The one part is, can I do what they ask me to do in a pro-style workout? Am I going to run a sub 760? Am I going to throw the ball on a line to the base? Am I going to be accurate? When I field 5 ground balls, am I going to pick every ground ball? Am I going to put the throw in the guy's chest? Okay? And that's no pressure. But you think that's pressure because you got guys sitting out there evaluating you, right? Where does the pressure come from? Where does the pressure come from? In the game, right? In the game. You will see some of the most talented athletes shine in pro-style workouts. They will shine. Wow, holy cow, man. I wish I was that big, strong, that fast. I wish I threw that hard. And then you put them in the game, doesn't know how to take an extra base, is in the wrong spot in the cutoff, can't execute a bunt, can't execute a hit and run, can't do any of that stuff. Okay, so you have to prepare yourselves for whatever the next level is, okay? You can't just go write a check and get a uniform and walk around and think that you're it. Okay, we do all these trials all over the place. We know what all the big dogs are. We know all the organizations that have the national teams, okay? And they show up and they play in those events, all right? But then we see all of the everything underneath it that shows up in that uniform and you're going, dude, okay, he plays for that organization. I bet he's pretty good. And guess what? Doesn't get out of round one. Don't let that fool you, okay? Another piece of this puzzle here as far as the travel showcase baseball goes, right? If you go ahead and you look deep into the guys that are in the big leagues and deep into the guys that are getting drafted, all right? Not everyone's a first round pick, right? Not everyone played on these top dog teams. And what happens is the guys that get to the big leagues, you'll find more of those subpar guys, those fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth round guys down. that find a way to wiggle all the way through to the big leagues, because their entire life they were on the other side of the big dog uniform, and they were figuring out how to compete. They were figuring out how to get it done, okay? They were figuring out how to face the guy that's throwing 90, and I gotta compete, I gotta put the bat on the ball, I don't wanna strike out. I wanna go. And those guys whittle their ways through, okay? So don't get fooled by that stuff, okay? It's not all negative, I'm not being negative on all that stuff, but find that situation where you are gonna be challenged. You're not walking on the field and shoving on everybody on the other side and only playing four innings and not getting your innings in and not getting your at-bats in. Okay? Be smart. Parents, you have to make that decision. Sometimes the parents are the worst culprits in this thing, because they want to sit around the water cooler and say, guess what? My kid plays for that team. Okay? What team? A, B, C, D, blue, black, white, yellow? Which team? Okay? I'd much rather be the one that says my kid got three hits off that team. Okay? So USA Baseball is the one organization in all the youth space where you truly have to prove yourself all the way through. A check that clears doesn't get you a uniform. Your talent gets you a uniform. Your talent gets you the opportunities at the next level, okay? College coaches don't call me up and go, hey, what team does he play for? What's his batting average, whatever. They wanna come see him play and they wanna see him perform on the field. Make sense? Okay, so I encourage you guys to do that. I am a big, big, big fan of USA Baseball. I say there's five uniforms that we wear in our lives that really mean anything. Five uniforms, okay? One is the very first uniform you ever put on. How many of you guys put on a uniform the first time and slept in it? I did. Huh? Slept in that uniform. More proud. Unbelievable, right? Slept in that uni, man. I played for Dew Electric. I remember it to this day, like Sean was talking about, the experience. Dew, I don't know if we won anything that year or not. I played for Dew Electric. The next uniform that meant something to me was my high school uniform. Because all my peers back then, we started in that first uniform, and we played together all the way up through the system. We didn't go play for this team over here or that team over there in the summer, okay? The same group of guys that wore Dew Electric were the same group of guys that wore Patchogue Medford High School uniform. The next uniform for me was a college uniform. Okay, I was too small. I wasn't going to be drafted. There was no chance. My recruiting story is bizarre, if I told you what it was. I'll fill you in. My next uniform was college uniform. I got to the University of Maryland because my dad, my stepfather at the time, caught for Jack Jackson, who was out of Shipley years and years and years ago, right after Bert Shipley, who was the first coach. Okay? He came up to Patchogue in New York to watch me play. And didn't get there before infield, and I was taking a ground ball infield, and I threw a short ball, and I rolled over my ankle. Didn't play, okay? Didn't play the game. Came to my house that night, because my father was his very first captain. Came to my house that night, sat down, had dinner, and my mother fed him two bottles of wine, got him plastered. And he gave me a scholarship at the end of the night. That's my recruiting story, okay? That's not gonna happen to you guys, I promise. So, I end up at the University of Maryland, long hair, wearing denim earth shoes, okay? And I have no idea where I'm at, what's going on. But I step on the field with an opportunity that I didn't think I was gonna have. But I got to wear a college uniform. That was my third uniform, okay? My fourth uniform wasn't so much a professional baseball uniform, that was part of my goal. I wanted to play pro ball. I didn't realize I could play pro ball because when I went to Maryland, I went there because my mother got the guy drunk. That's why I went to Maryland, okay? But as I got there and I got around other players and I started to see, okay, where do I stack up in this situation? Where do I stack up? Okay, that guy got drafted, I think I'm better than him, okay? That guy playing over there at Clemson is an All-American? I could be an All-American. So what do you do in that situation? You gotta work, you gotta put the effort in, you gotta go. If you want this, it's not gonna be handed to you. None of this will ever be handed to you, I promise. It may be handed to you now and you can go write a check and get a uniform. You go to this organization, that organization, because they got 40 teams and they're trying to fill it up, okay? Well, you're gonna get to a certain point where it's gonna be no mas, man, no mas. You earn it or you don't. I did get a chance. I got drafted by the Baltimore Orioles, 12th round at the University of Maryland. Okay, I go to Bluefield, West Virginia. Played my first year in rookie ball. Cal Ripken, graduated the same year I did from high school. Cal went to the big leagues. I went from rookie ball to AAA. I thought for sure I got this thing managed, man. I'm going to be in the big leagues in no time. It's going to be Ripken to Schaefer to Murray. Guess who was behind me? Billy Ripken. And Billy Ripken couldn't carry my glove. He'll tell you to this day. He could hit a little bit better than I did, but he couldn't carry my glove. Okay? And we still go back and forth about that. But the nepotism of it was, and Billy was a good player, don't get me wrong, Ripken to Ripken to Murray. So now how am I going to get to the big leagues? I'm boxed out by brothers. I got one in the big leagues, and I got one coming up behind me. Coming up behind me. How am I going to get to the big leagues? Because that was my fourth uniform that I wanted to wear, was a big league uniform. I spent eight and a half years in the minor leagues. Okay? At every level I was at, guys, every level that I was at, that was my big leagues. What you're playing today is your big leagues. Okay? You got to take care of business right here. You got to take care of business right now if you want the opportunity to wear these other uniforms. 8.5 years later, I go into spring training as a non-roster invite, and I get invited to stay when everybody else is getting cut. And if you've ever been in spring training and you go in as a non-roster guy and you're wearing number 78, back then, your odds are slim. Your odds are slim. But what did I have? What did I have? I had an opportunity. I had a chance. How I got it? I got it. Now I got to take advantage of it. I worked myself through the whole system, okay, the whole spring training. About a week before, they called me down the line. They said, the golden words for anybody, and I hope everybody in this that ever put on a uniform, or you guys that are climbing this ladder, get to hear this someday, you're going north. Because when you hear you're going north, that means you made the club. But when you make the club, as a non-roster guy and you don't have a contract, you don't sign your contract until you get to about an hour before game one. And I know this, right? So we're gonna fly out of Florida, we're gonna go to Oakland. We're gonna open up in Oakland. And I know that anything can happen from this point. I'm number 78. Nobody knows who I am. I'm number 78. But I'm on the plane, so what do? I go and lock myself in the bathroom so they can't come get me on the plane. And then finally I hear, Schaefer, come out of the bathroom. You can come out of the bathroom now. You're gonna make the club, I promise. So they unlock the door and I come out. I get a big round of applause. And I sign my contract an hour before. I wore my fourth uniform, okay? Every one of these uniforms that I had to wear, I had to make, I had to earn. Nobody bought them for me. Nobody paid for them, okay? I had to make the club. North Patchogue Method Youth Athletic Association, Dew Electric, we had tryouts. Had to make the club. Had to make my high school team. Had to make the college team. Had to make it to pro ball, and I had to make the big league team, okay? The fifth uniform is USA Baseball, okay? There's nothing that brings greater pride, and I'm proud of everything I've done in the big leagues, and anybody that's played in that level will tell you they're proud of it. Nothing means more to me now than to know that some of the guys that I helped select to get to the process or get them through the system came home from overseas with a gold medal and represented their country. And nothing makes me as proud or more proud as the guys that put themselves in the situation to do it. How many guys are in the big leagues that tried out for USA Baseball and didn't make the program? Didn't make the team. And there's a lot of guys those guys are in the big leagues. And then there's a lot of guys that made USA Baseball that never got to the big leagues. But they all put themselves in a situation to go ahead and compete. And that's the one thing I want you guys to take away from here. Two things, okay? One, what you're doing right now is an experience. And parents, do not take the experience away from these kids. We've lost that. It's a big piece. Sean and I have had this conversation before. We've had it on his podcast. I talk about it all the time on mine, okay? You guys are fortunate because someday they're gonna take this uniform off you and you can't put it on again to go play. You may be able to put it on to go coach, but you can't put it on to go play again. And I tell our kids all the time down in Charlotte, that's where I'm at now, CBC, Carolina's Baseball Center is our facility and our organization. You have no idea when I'm writing that lineup before every game how I wish I could scratch my own name in there. Now I got two sons playing, so I get to write Schaefer in there twice, but it's not me, it's the wrong guy, all right? But that's the part right there. Do not lose the fact that you guys are getting to play a kid's game. And I was a kid until I was 35. We were talking earlier. I told my wife at 35 years old when I first came out of the womb. I had to grow up starting at 35. How perfect was that? I'm still not growing up, guys, I promise, okay? Still not there, because I get to be around you guys, and I get to be around this game, and I get to be around people that love it, okay? But don't lose the piece of experience. Don't lose that. Understand that your kid's out there having a good time. A coach will tell you, parents, a coach will tell you that the first voice they hear on a baseball field is not coming out of the coach's mouth. It's coming out of the parent's mouth. Because you're the same one that says, take the garbage out, clean your room, go wash my car, do your homework, okay? That's the first thing that they hear. Don't let that happen. The first thing they should hear coming out of your mouth is not a negative thing. It's root them on, cheer them on, enjoy it. Because you don't know where this game's gonna take them. It could end tomorrow, it could end when you're 35 like it did for me, knock on wood. Very, very fortunate, okay? So, the experience, capture opportunity, carpe diem, seize the day, seize the moment, all these cliches that are out there, take advantage of it, okay? There are guys, I promise you, that are taking this thing so serious that they're working at it every single day. When I say working at it every day, that doesn't mean you have to go take 100 swings batting cage. You don't have to work on your fastball. I'd lay in bed all day long, throw the ball around, grab four seams, because I knew I had to throw the ball across the diamond four seams. I could do it to this day. I could find it anywhere I wanted. That's part of doing something. 10,000 hours is the magic number. 10,000 hours. If any of your parents ever read Outliers, it's a good book. If you haven't, pick it up and read it. It takes 10,000 hours to master something. When I was told it's going to take me 10,000 hours to do something, and I had to look back at my career after I was 35 and done, I'm like, did I put in 10,000 hours? 10,000 hours of taking a super pinky and throwing it off the wall at my elementary school and catching it. Okay? It was throwing the ball in the air, finding four seams to throw it. And over time, you'll be surprised when you look back and you figure out you put in 10,000 hours if you want it. How many of you guys do something every single day with this game? Batman. Every single day, okay? Sounds like a lot, but it's not. Something simple, okay, pick up the bat, take five swings. But don't just take five swings. Take five swings. Imagine you're facing somebody, okay? Imagine facing somebody in the big leagues. How many of you guys have played games and you won the World Series? Any of you guys won a World Series? You haven't won it in your mind? Yeah? I've won a million of them in my mind. Throwing that ball against the wall, I gotta make this play, I gotta make this backhand, I gotta go across the diamond with it. Game over. I'm a world champion. Never got the chance to be a world champion. Okay? All this stuff, okay? Experience, opportunity. When you get the opportunity, grab it. Okay? I don't have any magic dust here when it comes to teaching you guys how to play infield. Okay? All I have is stuff to reinforce. Okay? How many infielders do we have here? Okay, if I'm just talking to the infielders, I'm the outfielders, going to tune out. Attaboy. There's an honest man right there. Okay? This game is becoming more complicated than it really is. It takes a good athlete. It takes a good mind. 12 million different scenarios. I said million. 12 million different scenarios in a 9-inning ball game can take place. And this is a game of anticipation. Imagine that, right? So you guys are working on certain things. We're working on the things when we go through our practices, and Sean's putting you through them, all these coaches are putting you through them. We're working on the things that happen the most in the game. But somehow we got to be able to anticipate and react on all the other things. The game has become sabermetrics, okay? The sabermetrics part, I don't get. The technology stuff, I do. You guys are lucky. I wish I had this stuff going on. I wish I had this. Keep telling myself, man, if I had some things like that, or if I coached before I played, how much better would I be? How many coaches are here? Huh? What if you guys coached before you played? Might be pretty good, huh? I think so. We learn more on the other side of the game than we do, but we have to process as we're going through, and we have to learn as we're going through. So we don't want to overcomplicate things, all right? And I'm going to keep this real simple, and I'm going to peel it off after this. There's two cars, okay? There's two cars at a stoplight. One's dead set, and the other one's creeping up. And the light turns green. Which one's going to get the better jump? I want you to think about that every time a pitch is getting thrown to you infielders. Okay? Because we have to get our feet moving. Okay? We have to get our bodies going. We have to get in motion. We got to be prepared to go in multi-directions, and we got to be ready to move. And we have to go play the baseball. We can't allow the baseball to play us. The best infielders in the game, the best infielders in the game not only have good hands, okay, they have great feet. They have great feet. And you have to get those feet moving before the pitch is thrown so you can create range. You can create opportunity. You can go on a soft pick. So the simplest way to go about that, right? We're talking about timing earlier. We're sitting up there, we're talking about hitting, okay? Some of the things that people are missing right now is they can't get timing. It's the same thing when you're playing defense. You have to have timing. This guy gets ready, he winds up, he gets ready to release the ball. As he gets ready to release the ball, I better be in a position to move, okay? If this guy's releasing the ball and I'm standing flat foot like that, and that ball gets put in play, how many hops before I'm gonna react? I gotta be able to react off the bat. I gotta be able to move immediately. So it's like a dance, okay? It's always a dance. Guy's getting ready to go, he's gonna go throw. I'm stepping with him, I'm dancing with him. And if your team is taught right, your coach right, and you can look out on the field, every single player on the field is making the same move at the same time. They're all stepping up and they're all getting themselves to the balls of their feet. And they're getting ready to move, okay? We do drills down in Charlotte with our teams. We'll sit there and I'll have pitchers throw their pen. I'll have five pitchers gonna throw 15 to 20 pitches. And my defense will just sit out there. And every time he gets ready to throw the ball, they have to prep. So your dive step and your prep step is huge, okay? It's huge, okay? So the way I would go about it, you got the throw, I would always just kind of step forward. I always want to go in the direction of the ball, okay? I always want to do things as a defensive player or anything, athletically or naturally, right? Okay? So if I'm going to get myself ready to go field, am I going to go, right? Am I going to walk down the hall at school like this? No, you'll never get a date. Okay? What you have to do is we gotta prep. We gotta do everything naturally, okay? So I'm gonna step up, I'm gonna prep, I'm gonna get the ball to my feet, and then I'm gonna get a bounce. Okay? Then I'm gonna get a hop, because which car is gonna get off the line quicker? The one that's moving. Okay? Real simple. Okay? And this is not rocket science, this is nothing new. Okay? I'm not gonna come up here and throw data and stats at you and all that other stuff. This is basic 101. And if you can master 101, you'll be a better player. Okay? Once I set my feet, okay, once I get there, once I bounce and I'm in the right way to move, okay, I know that I'll be agile. I know I can react multi-directionally. The other thing that I wanna do is I wanna set my body. I have to set my body. I gotta get to an angle, okay? Because I can't go like this and think I'm gonna move right quick. How many guys play basketball? Just in the street. When you're guarding somebody, do we guard somebody straight up? Or do we get over? We get over, right? It's an athletic position. We're always getting ourselves in an athletic position. We're athletes. We play sports. We're athletes. Okay? Once I get there, so what I would do is I'd go ahead, I'd step, I'd prep, I'd bounce, and I'd make sure that my chin was past my toes. If my chin was past my toes and I couldn't see my toes, I knew I was on the balls of my feet and my engine was ready to go. I can move. I can react. I can go. Okay? And this is the position that I can move in. I can move in this position any way I want. Okay? I can go back. I can't move real well in this position. Because I'm high, what's going to happen when I get to the ball? I got to get down, right? Perfect. Once I get set, my hands, I got to get myself in position. How many of you guys flip? How many of you guys been taught this? You guys been taught this? I have no idea where this ever came from. Okay? I've never seen one guy in the big leagues set up and go like this. Ever. Okay? We set up in a position where we can move. Do you drive like this? We don't. We drive like this, right? It's the safest, most athletic way to go about it. So the visual that I would give is that I have a beach ball. So once I set my feet, okay, I prep, I get to the balls of my feet, then I gotta get my hands in position, okay? If I'm like this and I gotta go for range, what do I have to do with this hand? If I gotta go for a ball either direction, I gotta pull it all the way in, then I gotta go. He'll tell you, guys playing in the big leagues. How fast is this game in the big leagues? You think these guys are hitting, ground balls and shortstops and they're throwing guys out by 10 feet. You know how quick that is? These guys are getting down the line. The fastest guys from the left side, 3.839. 1,001, 1,002, 1,003. Did you get them? Everything is happening fast. We gotta put ourselves in that situation. So if I'm sitting here like this, and I'm uncomfortable, if I put myself in an awkward position and I'm not comfortable, I'm not athletic. Never athletic. So I imagine I got a beach ball. I'm gonna set up, right? Here he goes, there goes the pitcher. I'm gonna start my dance. Boom, set my leg, okay? Get to the balls of my feet, my chin's over there. Now I gotta get my hands set, I got a beach ball, boom, I'm here. Because if I gotta go that way, what do I have to do? A All I gotta do is turn. All I gotta do is go, right? All I gotta do is step back, pull it. But if I got something out here, if I'm sitting out here, and I gotta pull something in, and we're talking about speed of the game, and time and distance, okay? Time and distance makes a difference. We talked earlier about range, okay? I was over in Maryland today. Kid that's a senior, shortstop, great actions, great arm, throws the ball from different angles, got life on it, throwing it through the first baseman, okay? Why is this kid not drafted? Why was he not drafted as a junior? Why will that kid maybe get drafted but not get to the system? Because he's that much short on his range. He's that much short on his range. And maybe that's something that could be changed. He can change his opportunity to move forward. But he's just not putting himself in the right position to go. Okay? So we see that all the time. It all looks the same. Once we get to that position and we're here and the ball's hit, okay, I have to understand certain things in this game. And it gets a little bit, you know, above the pay grade right now. But you guys, if you start thinking about it now, you will react, and as you develop, you'll understand. We have to understand pace of ball, speed of runner. Pace of ball, speed of runner. Okay? I gotta know if this is a ball that I can sit back on a hop, or if this is a ball that I have to go get. But I have to be in a position athletically to decide to determine if that's what I'm gonna do. Okay? Got it? Once we get there, people talk about soft hands, okay? It's not soft hands, okay? It's soft arms, okay? The ball is soft this way, we feel, okay? This other piece here, I see you guys doing a lot of drills, okay? I'll tell you, man, I hope you guys watch Big League Baseball. If you're watching Big League Baseball, at least just watch the guy that plays your position. Watch the guy that pitches. Watch how he's spotting the ball. Watch what he's doing. Watch how he's changing eye levels. Watch how he's changing speeds. If you're an infielder, watch how this guy positions himself on certain hitters. Watch how he sets his feet. Watch how he goes, okay? Once we go to field the baseball, okay, we have to bring things in naturally. If I go after a baseball, a ground ball, and I'm moving forward, and I go like this, and I go this way at a ball, okay, that's taking me out of my natural position, okay? I'm not gonna walk down the hall at school like this, right? I'm not going that route. Okay? I'm gonna walk down the hall just this, but my arms flow. Same thing, ground ball comes at me, body set, boom. I bring everything into me. I gather myself, I get myself in line, okay? I get my glove side on the target, and I throw and I follow. It's real simple, okay? It's real simple. I'm gonna finish up right here, Sean. Okay? On the defensive side, the number one rule, if you guys don't take anything away from this, on the defensive side, the number one rule playing defense is catch the baseball. You catch the baseball, we'll work on everything else. If you don't catch the baseball, you can't throw the ball. We can't work on anything else, okay? It's a game of repetition. We want to hit, we want to throw, we want to do all that other stuff, and we don't want to field as much as we should. How many of you guys go to the park just thinking, I'm just going to take ground balls today? That's all I'm going to do. I got to the big leagues as a utility man. Last thing I'll leave with, I would take 50 ground balls in third, 50 ground balls in second, 50 ground balls in short. And then you know what I would do after that? I'd go warm up Randy Johnson before a start. That part wasn't fun. I didn't enjoy that one bit. Okay, my point was, I put myself in a situation. My game at that point was to be prepared. And my game at that point was to take the opportunities that were going to come my way, whether it's the seventh inning on and I was going in to play for Edgar Martinez because he couldn't run and he couldn't field. And I was going to go into the nut cutter game, one run up, one run down, and I can't make a mistake. I had to be prepared. And then when I look back, I had 10,000 hours that prepared me. Okay? I had 10,000 hours that did it. Put your hours in, guys. See how far this game will take you. And if it doesn't take you as far as you want to go as a player, you're going to be a dad someday. And you're going to take your kid and you're going to put him in the same situation as you want. You're going to want to give him the best. Be prepared to prepare him. Okay? That's it. I'm done. Thank you.